is the Come Up Show, where that feel good music lives. Real, recognized, real. I'm very excited to have the opportunity to interview one of the realest MCs that is doing his thing. Please introduce yourself to the people out there.
What's up, my brother Ali? Thank you for having me on your show. I appreciate it.
Long for y'all to come out here and take me in the home. The world's so cold with no place to belong. He said, come on in, boy, sing me a song. He stepped inside and to his surprise, it was so damn fly.
I know in your album, your last album, you thank all your fans for who you are, man. How important are your fans?
It's everything. I mean, there's a big difference between, artists who have a big machine behind them. You know, they go to great lengths to make sure that certain songs are played on the radio, you know, 30 times, you know, X amount of times a week. And more of us have to do it the way that we're doing it, which is independent. And our touring and our live show and just us who we are our marketing department. And it's a beautiful thing to know that whatever success we achieve is because the people carried us to that. We do have an independent label, Rhyme Sayers, and the people there are amazing, but it's four people, you know what I mean? For, you know, 25 artists, we got four people basically that really make that label work, you know what I mean? And then whatever, you know, interns that they have and whatever other people that are around. But for the most part, it's a really small group of people. And then we have local independent promoters like we have tonight. You know, every now and then we get somebody like you on the radio that's cool, that wants to show us some love from time to time, you know. But, you know, so but it really is people and the way that they feel about our art that has taken us to wherever we are.
When there is no balance, when mainstream radio is playing all this music, commercial music, is that a good thing for artists like you? Because if I'm hearing the same thing 12 songs a day, every day, all day, and I put in a Brother Ali record, isn't that so much more refreshing to me to hear your music and like to hear that?
I think yes and no. For people who think for themselves, people who think critically, then yeah. It makes us want to completely abandon the system. But there are a lot of people who aren't trained to think for themselves. Critical thinking is a skill that most people learn in their development of, you know, being a human being. You know, it's similar to, you know, you start out with somebody feeding you, and then you learn how to hold your own fork, and then you learn how to boil water, and then you learn how to cook, and then you learn how to grow a garden. And this is natural growth and evolution as a human being. And at least in the States, we don't think critically, and we don't criticize things. We just accept what's given to us because we're completely unaware that we can go and find and build our own everything. And so when you have a situation like that, it really is a lot more, it hurts a lot more when those few sources that are feeding the people the little bit of the small diet that they get are so exclusive. I'm not mad at the artists that are doing what they're doing, but it is really a problem that children aren't exposed to anything outside of that. You know what I mean? When there's a balance, there's less, you know, a friend of mine, Jay Smooth, was making the point that it was okay for there to be N.W.A. because, you know, when N.W.A. was really going hard, like, they were way on they were making purposefully negative music. And that was all right because at the same time, there was Public Enemy making the most positive music they could. And then there was De La Soul, just like, hey, we're just going to be ourselves. And then you had, you know, guys like Rakim just spitting amazing lyrics. You had people like Scarface and Ice-T teaching you, like, all right, if you get involved in the streets, this is what it's like. It's fun when you're doing it, but then these are the consequences. So you had I grew up on a balanced diet within my music. I heard music from so many different personality types, you know what I mean? And now we're only getting a very, very small, the kids that are only exposed to the radio are given such a small, limited menu, you know what I mean?
Stand tall, I raise my fist. I pray all this pain might lift. I don't wanna die tonight, but I can't live another day like this. I stand tall, I raise my fist. I pray all this pain might lift.
What are you, what is your son and your daughter surrounded, or what are they consuming every day if you cut off the TV and the radio?
Well, they get what we choose for them. You know what I mean? And we try to offer them a wide variety of stuff. You know, my daughter's two, and when Michael Jackson comes on, she knows that's Michael. Even if it's a song she hasn't heard, she knows Michael Jackson's voice. She knows the Beatles. You know, she knows when she's hearing Jay-Z. My son, his ability to memorize lyrics is extensive. And so I just, you know, every month or so I make him a new CD of, you know. And I put some things on there that some people wouldn't let their kids listen to. You know what I mean? But I really want him to be aware of everything that's out here. You know what I mean? And try as we may to mask it with names, such as your religion or your plastic erase. The same color blood just passed through our veins, and tears taste the same when they splash on your face. The world.
So let's talk about that, about the album Us. You said it's not about me, it's not about you, it's about us. Why don't you expand on the concept of your album?
Well, the idea is that is me trying to get my listeners to see themselves in other people that don't come from their same background. Like I have, you know, the really unique situation in life where I've been exposed to and close and intimate with groups of people who are socially pushed away from each other, socially polarized. I was a Christian for half of my life, and I've been a Muslim for the second half of my life. I lived in the suburbs for part of my life, in the hood for part of my life. My family is white. All of my friends and people, you know, you have your family that God gives you, and then the ones that you build around yourself. And I've had these experiences to be intimate and close with different groups of people, and I know for a fact that they don't know each other. More specifically, privileged people and don't have any idea what other people are going through, what oppressed people go through. And so I decided to make an album of stories. You know, whereas my previous albums were all my stories, and people would come to me and say, like, I feel like you're talking about me. I'm like, oh, really? You're homeless, single dad, independent artist, Muslim, albino from, you know. Nah. But you tell the story in a way that just talks about what it feels like. And they're like, oh, I feel that, because we're all human beings, you know. I'm saying, I hear these people say words like, you know, oh, that's so ghetto. Or you know, why are you acting like a crackhead? I'm like, okay, well, I've lived in the ghetto, and I've got the people you're calling crackheads in my family. So let's talk about what that really is. And can I tell those stories in a way that makes a person from a more privileged background relate to it and understand this is a person like me? That could be my mom, or that could be my brother, that could be me, you know, that could be my best friend. You know, it was important to me for people to see ourselves in each other, and that's what the idea of that album is.
I believe no matter where you come from, what you look like, or what language you speak, all of us are exactly the same underneath. Can somebody say right on? Can somebody in London, Ontario tonight say right on? And if we're going to use this music to heal this old sick, decrepit world and make it start to get better, all of the common people have got to come together. Can somebody say right on? Somebody say right on.
I like this line that you say, you did music to become someone, but it made you realize that you were someone. Yeah. Can you? How did music make you realize?
Well, I mean, it's music, but it's hip hop specifically. Like, hip hop is the music of oppressed people. It's the voice of oppressed people, voice of voiceless people. The best hip hop has always said, you know, I'm not this low thing that you think I am. I'm actually incredible, and here's proof of it. You know what I mean? And I think that's something we lose also when we, you know, people who are newer to hip hop really like to criticize what they call materialism in the mainstream stuff. So they're just like, you know, these guys are so full of shit with their chains and their cars. And but if you don't come from their background and come from their environment, it's easy for us to leave out the fact that they're in one of the richest countries in the world, but they come from the worst ghetto in that situation. Systematically and institutionally, they have no access to all the riches of the country that they live in. Like, they're kept out by design, again, you know. And so for them to have used this music to achieve some kind of success, that in itself is a revolutionary thing. And so a chain and a car and all this stuff is not it's not just about the actual chain, it's a symbol of what they've been able to achieve because of their talent and because of their how magnetic that artistic creative force is within them, you know. And so that's what hip hop did for me, like as a person who was able to see it for the human thing that it was, you know, and not just like all, you know, not just play it to the side or whatever, but it's what all my friends were doing, you know what I mean? But it spoke to me in particular because as a person that moved all the time and you know, never really had money to look nice and you know, obviously being albino and can't play sports and I'm legally blind and it's just difficult for me to operate in life. That's not a good situation to be in as a kid. But that always, rhyming always gave me a way to, when I showed up somewhere, gave something, I had to give them something way more captivating than the fact that I'm albino and I look crazy. You know what I mean? Seriously, like I had to be like, you know, it's almost like a magic trick. Like, you know what I mean? Look over here. Like, pay no attention to the albino behind the curry. You know what I mean? But the reality is that, I mean, I haven't worked for anybody else since 2002. You know, I come from working 2 and 3 jobs at a time. There's times where I've had 3 jobs. I come from working 2 jobs and still starving. You know what I mean? And still not being able to make all my, you know, pay all my bills and all this kind of stuff. That's what I come from. And so to go from that, to go from working for somebody else for, you know, 12 and 14 and 16 hours a day, and then falling asleep on the bus to the next job and then hoping to wake up on time to get off the bus at the right place, to go to the next job, and that was like the best sleep that I would get, you know. You know, just year after year of living like that. And then for the music that I love to do, being the thing that actually makes me a comfortable person is ridiculous.
But you can use the power of music to reach all those people and to tell that story, to motivate and inspire and let people know what is happening. Yeah. You know, and that's a blessing that you have.
And I hope that when people, you know, when my fans who have no connection to the, you know, the real urban situations, what they call the hood, the ghetto, the slum, whatever, I hope that when they have some interaction with it, maybe the stories that I've told will make them look at it a little bit differently. Or I hope that, you know, there's so much anti-Muslim rhetoric going on in the news right now that I hope that they would hear some of that and just think to themselves, like, well, Brother Ali's not like that. You know what I mean? And I'm a practicing Muslim. I'm a praying 5 times a day, fasting Ramadan, going on Hajj, read the Quran in Arabic. Muslim, like, I am a Muslim. You know what I mean? And I think hip-hop had a lot to do with our country electing Barack Obama. Not directly, you know, it's not just because Jay-Z said vote for him, you know, so it's less, you know, it's less foreign to see Barack Obama on TV and be like, I like that guy, you know what I mean? I think the hip-hop had a whole lot to do with that.
First off, I want to say thank you very much for this opportunity to sit down and very informative and inspiring story. I feel like happy that, you know, you say you've made it and you can speak for the people and you can do something about it and to the best of your ability. Is there anything else that you wanted to say before we wrap at it?
I just want to thank you too. Thank you for sharing your time with me and thank you for playing me on your show and having me on this interview. Thank you
very much. Brother Ali called the office. This is the Come Up Show that Feel Good Music Lives. Real, recognize real. We out.
Everybody is out here saying mean the word peace, and then we're gonna be out here, we're gonna walk around saying no. I love y'all very much. 1, 2, 3.
Peace.
1, 2, 3.
Peace.
1, 2, 3.
Peace.
Peace, y'all. Rhyme City is number 1.